tonight on 8.5 Bit. We get horny, we get horny, and we get horny. Welcome, friends of all the science, to episode 287 of 8.5 Bit. And the games from tonight's intro, of course, are Horny from Bowser's Fury, because he's a horny creature. Valheim, where we are Vikings and well-horned. Horns,
and of course, Dungeon Keeper 2.
Yeah. Honey Pop 2, which...
I don't remember seeing any horns in Honey Pop 2.
I am your host, Paul, and joining me tonight, I'm a good friend, Sam.
Hi.
And James.
Hello.
That's the backwards order.
Oh, I should have pulled rank and been like, you guys cannot talk until I say your name. Shut up.
Too bad. Too late.
And we have been offline for a little while, as we keep being at the moment anyway, because we're adult men and we have other things to do in our lives. James has had a child.
Yes, that's knocked me out for a while.
Which he has named after his favorite Star Wars characters, the robots from...
Roger.
Yep, from Phantom Menace.
Not Space Quest at all.
Love those? No.
Definitely. Yeah. I just thought, like, I should really name my kid after a loser janitor from an adventure game series.
Well, it's good to be aspirational. He achieves things. He goes through time.
Yeah, he does. He's dumb luck. He does end up captaining a spaceship. Well, it's like a garbage truck.
Yeah,
it's a space garbage.
It's a space garbage truck.
Is that ship shaped like a toilet? There is a ship that's shaped like a toilet.
No, I think there is, but I think the one he flies is more shaped like a vacuum cleaner because it goes around sucking things up.
Kind of like Spaceballs.
Yeah, I think it's a bit like...
Which came first?
I might be misremembering. It could be that he does look like a toilet.
You're supposed to be the expert.
It's been a long time since I played Space Quest 5.
Yeah, it's the best one.
It's actually one of the better ones.
I actually do quite like Space Quest
5. Yeah, it's one of the few that I finished without... No, I think the only one I finished without a walkthrough.
But nobody listening to this was alive when Space Quest 5 came out, so... Let's talk about Pokemon.
Me.
Yeah. But first, I got my present.
So this is the second part of James' birthday present, which is now only a month and a half late.
That's not
but
too
I've
bad.
Still beat your wife, haven't I?
Oh, yeah. I think with Cheryl, I'm now about 3 gifts behind.
Oh, nice.
I think there's a Valentine's Day coming, there's a Christmas coming, and there's a birthday coming.
Sweet. Okay, Valentine's Day is well gone, my married friend.
My Christmas present for Amy finally showed up
nice.
A couple of months ago. That would have been Christmas 2018 that I ordered that.
Was it a Kickstarter? Kickstarter?
It wasn't. Oh. It was anime figures kept getting pushed back.
This works even better in audio format.
And it's getting all cranky. The official book of Leisure Suit Larry.
Here I was saying, why didn't he name his kid Larry?
Well, that's an excellent
almost, movie. Yeah. Just in my head.
So the other present I got you was basically the equivalent of this for Space Quest. Because back in the day, the old Sierra, they made these like compilations that were half narrative retellings of the game stories and half hint guide and half background information.
So you could read it like a book, but it also told you the answers to things.
Yeah.
Nice.
And just some background information. And like, I don't think they're particularly
Does it have the answers to the copyright protection?
I haven't seen. I admittedly did not read James's presents before I gave them to him.
I do like that the first thing I opened up to is a little bit problematic.
Oh yeah, good.
Where it had Larry being dressed as a woman at some point and says making a disguise is a drag. I mean, it's mildly, it's not super problematic, but
drag's still a thing.
It's a good play on words.
Yeah, actually,
it's still called drag.
RuPaul would be fine with that pun. Yeah. I mean, it's not as problematic as the Christmas present you gave me, which was Rex Nebula and the Cosmic Gender Bender. but, you know, it explains a lot about Paul. So that's fine.
Thank you, Paul.
You're welcome.
And it reminds us of the days where covers to things had no representation of what was actually internal.
Yes. And I think it's not written by Al Lowe, but it's like with the help
with the help of the games that he made.
Yeah.
We
once had a phone call with him. And so have we.
Yes.
Yeah. We call ourselves official acquaintances.
Daddy remembers us.
Okay, so it's a pretty... What? He doesn't remember an interview he did like 8 years ago with some randos on the internet for no reason whatsoever?
I can't even remember what we spoke about.
You guys
about.
Remember, surely.
I don't think he had any projects at the time. I think we just wanted to talk to him. I'm pretty sure he's retired. And then we were like pressuring him to do other things. So tonight will be relatively heavy because a lot have happened in the last few weeks. So Where do we begin?
Where do we begin?
Well, let's just start with some video games. Okay. Well, I've got a big list. Let's see if anyone else has been playing, like if we've got any crossover. Mm. Not particularly. No one else has played Bowser's Fury?
I have it. I haven't played it.
Okay.
The furry part.
Well, well, let's start with the hottest game of the current, which is a 7-year-old Wii U game, which is 3D Super Mario 3D World plus Bowser's Fury. Now, when this was first announced, I didn't pay attention. I thought Bowser's Fury was like another world they've added as DLC to 3D World, and I'm like, that's cool. Maybe I'll get it sometime. I'm not really rushing for it. But you know, nice. And then when I actually got around to looking at what it was, Bowser's Fury is, if you do not know, an entirely different game that's attached to the package. Mm. And from the main screen, you actually just get to pick between 3D World or Bowser's Fury. You don't have to do anything to unlock it. It's two separate games that have the same starting executable. Bowser's Fury is a very interesting experiment by Nintendo. It sits somewhere between 3D World and Odyssey.
Okay.
Then doing a few bunch of different stuff as well.
Because I wasn't sure if it'd be something, even though it was a separate thing, it'd kind of expect you to have played through the first one and bring that knowledge in.
No.
Okay.
It's, yeah, now, it uses some of the same assets. Separate. Uses some of the same assets. I assume it's running basically the same engine. But where 3D World is basically isometric viewpoint, fixed camera angle, this is a full 3D Mario game. Get camera control on the right stick. You want to turn that sensitivity up, because especially when there's battles in that game, you're like, God, I'm just turning. Turn that sensitivity up. That's my number one tip. So it's basically the first foray into a fully blown open world Mario game. You are on a series of islands. They start off just locked to like three, and then as you keep going along, it opens up at a bigger and bigger area. And Bowser has been infected by Venom. Some black tar. Yeah. Let's call it Venom. So the game is basically, each of these islands, if you were to separate them, would just be like a level in a Mario game. They are somewhat separate. But because it's in all this persistent world, every once in a while, and I think it's basically on a timer, I never worked out exactly if it was always the same time, Bowser wakes up. And when Bowser wakes up, it starts to rain first, and then things go to hell, and he jumps up, and he's, you know, 150 foot tall.
Mm.
Actually, maybe bigger. I don't get a measurement. But he'll get angry, and they'll rain big stones down from the sky, and he'll shoot fire at you, and then he'll do like a big blasty Godzilla style like blasty laser. Now the big blasty laser is good for destroying things. So on each island, there's at least one set of blocks that can only be destroyed by the big blasty laser. So you want him to do that.
Yeah.
But those blocks that fall down, not only are they like hazards that can be in the way, they often will transform the area, so there'll be alternate pathways or things you couldn't get before or everything. So even though it's a more dangerous state, it actually offers more opportunity to do things. And in fact, so to move between the islands, you get the little Loch Ness monster, I think it's called Nessie from 3D World. Yep. And you go around in the ocean with them, and they've got a great little mechanic where there's a dive button. And if you push the jump button when you come up from the dive, you get a speed boost. Why? Because it's a video game. But when Bowser's stuff starts going on, pulls up all these like curved ramps and shit in the water, and suddenly you're like doing more stuff. It's great fun. So anyway, as you go around, you're collecting cat shines, because it's very cat themed, this expansion, as 3D World was. It's got the cat suit in it. Once you've got enough shines, you can go and pick up a big cat bell, and then you turn into a similarly sized big cat Mario, and then you have a big Godzilla style battle with Bowser. You'll do that a number of times as the world expands. I quite like that, because you're still in the same environment. So suddenly you're towering above all the little islands you were just platforming around.
Katamari-like.
It's very fun getting that skill change. And then as it continues expanding, the islands will also sort of evolve, like, or move, like, sort of season states and weather states and stuff like that. So what it is it's this big area that keeps changing a little bit and offering new challenges. And there's 100 shines to get in the game. You beat the game at 50. But then it's just like, oh, just keep playing. There's just as many left.
I'm just wondering, because it sounds like there's, like, a lot going on in it.
Sounds like a very large Mario tech demo.
Well, or is it a COVID game where like they had like this big plan of like what this thing's going to be in COVID, It's like, oh shit, just like pull the scope right back.
I don't, because the thing is, the whole game, I haven't 100%ed it yet. Most people that have 100% put the 100% around 6 hours.
Okay.
So it's a quite a concise game. I think I've put about 4 hours in it and done half it. So it'll probably take me longer than 6 to 100%, but I don't have to prove myself. Stop judging me. but I don't, to scale just this idea up to like a real, like a 20 hour game.
Yeah.
Would seem like you do quite need quite a bit more.
Yeah.
But as this little concise experiment, it's very satisfying. Yeah. It's got a lot of good stuff. It's only 2-player when 3D World is 4-player. But in the 2nd player plays Bowser Jr. Now, I haven't actually played with anyone else. But either way, even if you're by yourself, Bowser Jr. is with you. And he does a little things. Like he's got a paintbrush. So if you see something on the wall, you can tap it and he might find a power-up or something. But you can also choose what AI you want for him. So say if you're a kid that's not very good at Mario, you can just tell him to go kick the shit out of anyone and he'll just pretty much automatically go and kill anyone that's around you. By default, it's on sort of like a friendly helper and he'll just like whack someone now and then, and it is quite helpful. Or you can just turn it off entirely, and while he'll be there, he won't really assist you.
Yeah.
So if you want a pure experience,
is that the way they have their difficulty levels?
I think a little bit.
It's kind of a cute way to do it.
It's a cute way to do it. It's quite natural. It doesn't help you with the platforming elements because probably the most frustrating thing about it, because it is a series of islands, all the challenges pretty much have to work vertically, because otherwise you could just float to the side of the island and get out at the goal.
Yeah.
So if the goal has to be high,
yeah,
which means if you're doing it, if it's a more difficult platforming thing and you fuck it up,
you have to go all the way back around.
Or, yeah.
Yeah.
Almost all challenges will have at least a shortcut halfway up.
Mm-hmm.
So that's nice of them to do. And especially since... Oh, actually, I'll get onto that. It's got the cat suit in it, so you can actually trivialize a bunch of things just by climbing up them. Which takes me to the other thing they're trying with this. There's a power-up inventory, which we've kind of had in like matte screens before and stuff. But straight up now, down the bottom of the screen, you've got each power-up. So you've got your cat suit, you got just your standard mushroom, you got your fire, you got your boomerang, you got your raccoon suit. I'm trying to think, or Tanuki, whatever you want. I think I'm missing one. But you can hold 5 of them at once.
Ooh.
And you can just push a button and say, Bowser Jr., chuck me one of my things.
Because 3D World had one you could hold and swap mid-level. Yeah, you could hold one.
But this has 25, 30.
It's a little bit more Zelda-like.
And also, one of the things that I've always hated about Mario, when you find the power up, it replaces your power up. No, it just chucks the one you were using in your inventory.
Oh, back in the inventory, yeah.
Yeah, and you can pull it back out. You can swap between them.
That's cool.
I'm like, okay. Now, it does trivialize some of the things, like, oh, I don't have to go hunting for things. I can just pull out a suit when it's appropriate. But that's more fun.
Yeah.
And if you want to be a purist of Mario, everything designed in that game is to be done without the suits. So you just don't push the button. It's like, I quite like the fact that I can just go, you know, this mini boss is a little annoying, but you know what would make him less annoying? A lot of fireballs in his face. Push that button, off we go. It's just very creative. It's doing the modern Mario thing where each area has its own gimmicks. So you basically, every island is its own unique thing and you'll find something there. And as I say, it can evolve and there's secrets to find.
Yeah.
And for a little pack-in, It's really put some real polish on a 7-year-old game. Which, 3D World is a fantastic game. It's one of the better Marios, I think.
Beautifully on the Switch.
Yeah,
too.
Runs really well on the Switch. High resolution, high frame rate. They've made some small changes. One of them is they've made the game faster. You move more quickly in the game, which is nice. You still get a crown.
That's the important part.
And they had to do a few things like the sticker... you used to collect stickers and they were for using with the... with the messaging service on the Wii U that doesn't exist anymore. But now they're used for something else.
I haven't figured out yet, but they're still there.
As I say, because I haven't played it myself, I've only seen the changes because I've been playing Bowser's Fury. Whenever you'd pick them up in the original game, it would pause the game and be like, you've got a sticker.
Yeah,
like, doesn't pause it anymore. Yeah!
You just pick it up and it shows you at the end of the level.
So a few little quality of life things. I'm like, okay, cool. So I think they've... Considering most people did not have a Wii U, did not play this game, I can certainly see it having the value of still being a full price game now, especially with that add-in, which just, it's very cool. Yeah.
It'd be nice if when they do anything else that they port across, because I'm sure there's still a whole bunch of stuff that they
well, yeah, what else they have? What other?
Because they have ported things already, like Pikmin's come across, yeah. And it's now Pikmin 3 Deluxe.
What's left to port?
Yeah, what other Wii U games have we got to pull over?
Only things that don't really work on the Wii U, like Nintendo Land and Warrior Game and Watch. And
because if there was anything left, it'd be nice if that became the standard of like, okay, we're gonna port it, we're gonna quality of life, and we're gonna put something new with it.
Yeah,
just to really.
I think they're just already worth it though.
Mm.
But this is the last one, then it's kind of pointless.
Well, we might find out tomorrow morning, which will probably be 3D. Well, I don't know when it'll release. It's probably on Sunday still. So several days ago, when they're having their first Nintendo Direct since 2019. So, but I feel it will be underwhelming because Nintendo doesn't surprise me very much anymore.
We're not getting Metroid Prime 4,
but they also do surprise.
I doubt we'll get any Breath of the Wild 2 news.
Yeah.
Well, because it's focusing on the releases in the first half of the year.
Yes.
Which we know is like Pokemon Snap and existing games are already out like Smash Bros. But also, Nintendo are in the habit now of only just announcing
dropping
games,
stuff on us.
Yeah, 2 to 3 months before release. So that still means it could put anything. I'm assuming there's going to be Zelda 35th anniversary stuff. And the rumor is it's an Ocarina of Time remake.
Ah.
And I think people are... going to be very disappointed with that word remake when what they'll probably do is just the same they did with 3D All-Stars.
Can we get Zelda 35? So Zelda Battle Royale?
Probably yes. but unfortunately, you're removing it in March, so...
I was thinking you'd have original NES Zelda, so everyone's playing at once.
Yeah.
But when you kill things, it sends the enemies to the other screens.
To different screens.
Yeah.
You could quite do it.
That'd be really cool.
Yeah. It would work nicely with Zelda 2 as well. Would be a good one to put it on.
I'm hoping there's a Skyward Sword.
Maybe.
Eventually.
Maybe we get Switch remasters of the CDI games.
So, did you say you're hoping there's Skyward Sword?
Yeah.
I mean,
a lot of people do want
only
that.
If they just do what we say there and add a bunch of quality of life things. Good fuck
and
that
an
game.
Entirely separate game with it.
I like the Skyward Sword.
Why? It's got some great things, but that tutorial is like...
Oh, no, the tutorial. I would like a way to move through the 5-hour tutorial.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, the slog to get into the game.
When you
I'm
get
just
to the game,
to
the game parts, I enjoyed that part. But yeah, the tutorial is... Whew.
I hope you have to do the angled strokes by moving the entire Switch. There we go. Oh, they just do it like Revengeance, which is definitely a word.
100%.
Okay, cool. Let's jump into some other stuff. Well, let's hit the big ones that we mentioned here. So I'm pretty sure more than just I have played Honey Pop 2.
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, you've finished it, haven't you?
I finished the chunk that is the game.
Yeah.
I can keep playing it.
So not that we're a super family-friendly show to begin with, but just to remind people, Honey Pop is a pornography game of some sort. It is, gameplay-wise, a match... Oh, not match... Oh, I guess it's match 3.
I use match 3 as a catch.
Match 3
is
a genre.
For those kinds of things,
And it has risen above its pornographic nature because it is a very good match
it's
3.
It's annoyingly one of the best match games.
Yes. But just at the end of it, you get to see some... drawn people having post-sex,
which is I guess if you make the perfect match game, there is only one way to actually make it better.
Yeah,
and they've done
it. Exactly.
And this one is uncensored from the
correct,
start.
Yeah,
they've just
yes.
I think except on GOG.
Yeah, if you buy it on GOG, you have to put the patch on.
Yeah, that it was weird why GOG would be the exception.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, Steam's fully uncensored because Steam don't give a crap now.
Yep. Steam's a dirty, dirty boy.
It really is.
So, changes in this game. Story-wise, it's all about having threesomes. God.
I mean, where do you go from the first one? That is basically it.
What I hate about Honey Pop is that so much of it is so fucking pathetic and...
It's shoehorned in.
And just so the girls all have perks, detriments, I can't remember what they call them, aspects of the vessel.
Oh, yeah.
Baggage, and some of it's
emotional baggage, Paul.
Is so fucking problematic to the point that I cringe at myself.
Yep.
One of the girls doesn't shower very much, and her baggage is smelly pussy. And I'm like, can I play
when
this
that
game?
Came up, I just oh.
Can I actually?
There's just no. All I look at it and go, okay, what's the mechanics behind this?
Yeah,
and ignore the layer on top,
I can't
design layer.
Yeah, I can't remember what that one meant, what gameplay was.
Yeah, I don't know.
But it could be things like someone's like an attention seeker, and so they might pull focus every few moves or something like that.
It's interesting because there's all that baggage stuff changes the game enough to add challenge.
Oh,
it's
yeah.
It's just the like. The reasoning layer on top is very strange.
It's like, I could be like, oh man, this is so, like, I don't necessarily feel great about this, but I still want to see the naked drawing. And I want to play this match 3 game, which is surprisingly difficult.
Yeah, yes.
It's challenging.
So at this point, you're matching different elements. But you've got two people at once, so you have to juggle between the focus on them. They're like, oh, I'm going to match with you, and they've got the ones they like and the ones they dislike. And then you've got gifts which change your abilities in there, and then you've got this baggage on top. It's a shitload of things.
Yeah.
Oh yeah,
the stamina is
the big one.
Because I think the second after the tutorial, like the first puzzle, it's immediately difficult. Yeah. I think I failed like the very first.
It's like every match lowers the stamina, but if you match like 4, it's 2 stamina. If you match 5, it takes 3 stamina. And every match you do, the other girl gets a stamina back, so you have to like keep swapping between the two.
Yeah,
but so then if you randomly make a match and then it drops the bad ones down, you can just lose.
I've had a couple of just don't keep track of it. I'm like, what did I do? Well, one was the girl that had stole focus.
Yeah,
because I was like, oh, I'm gonna, so each girl you're matching with has stamina, so you actually can't necessarily do a big move against some people because they just don't have the energy. So, but you can also do that, and then strategically you can then get them back up in a few moves. Mm-hmm. So I was doing that, but the other girl stole focus, and she wiped, and that wiped the other girl. I'm like, no! Yeah, it's a lot to keep track of. It's a very complex backstory game.
Yeah.
The presentation is top notch.
It does feel like a sequel.
Yeah.
Like it's
ramped up.
Yeah,
for
like
sure.
I was expecting it would just be more. Mm. Like it, but no, they've added shit.
You can be a girl or a boy.
Yeah.
There is,
doesn't change any of the artwork.
Yes. There is a trans character which you're allowed to pick whether they're pre or post op, which I don't know if is a good or bad thing to be in a game. Someone please inform me.
I got the impression it wasn't about pre or post-op and more about just...
I thought it was a backlash.
What biological was.
A backlash?
No, because when they first announced it, there wasn't a choice.
Yeah,
then,
correct.
Then internet neckbeards got angry because they couldn't get their chivos without fucking a quote-unquote dude.
Oh, I hoped it would be the other way around, if anything.
Yeah,
it was purely reactionary. And so their compromise...
It was meant to be an actual just trans character.
The compromise was to put in the selector, and the selector defaults to female.
Oh.
So yeah, it was a bit disappointing, that part.
Mm. I mean,
and I found out that's the only thing that does change the artwork slightly.
Mm. Whether there's a bulge or not.
No.
I haven't got to the end, so I can't. Okay. I haven't seen completion.
There is one of the final images you get with that character that changes slightly in one of the matchups, the menage a trois.
I feel like if not PAX ever happens again, a large debate.
No, keep the first one.
That's what you title it.
The mass debate on the morality of like the ethics and morality of Honey Pop, because like it's very sex positive.
Yes,
And it is obviously a fantasy playing. Mm. Like it's not trying to paint itself as anything realistic.
All the women have agency.
Yes. Yeah. Yes.
There's one thing I found weird about it,
mm.
and that's that like when you first start getting into it and it's all about like, oh, you gotta like the girls have, you know, they match up so they'll be happy to have a threesome with you or whatever, and it shows you that like they're a good match, and that then after you do like one date it's there's romance. And like I was expecting at some point to hit a pair that didn't have that, where it said, oh no, these girls don't work together. No,
they're all compatible. Well,
they're
one
all
the,
compatible.
One of the early
and some
ones
of
is,
them are a bit of a stretch.
Yeah. Well, one of them steals from another one.
Yeah.
And then it goes then like compatibility detective.
Like, what? Because they've interacted, basically.
Yeah. Because you are attracted to drawn anime girls.
There is some lore to explain it. Because they do say early on that the whatever the pop computer, whatever thing, does detect the matches.
Yes.
So you know whichever one you visit, there will be a match.
Yeah.
Oh, but it's true. You go there with prior knowledge.
Yes, yeah. It's detected that there's a pre-existing match.
And we do have skipped the overall story, which is to save the world because ancient sex demons or something?
The nymphogen.
Nymphogen.
Are going to wake up because they do so every 10,000 years.
Why don't they just call it a fuck genie?
And they have extreme PMS.
Oh, God, that's
so
right.
So what you got to do is you got to wake them up early and fuck it out of them. That's the storyline.
Is this empowering or the worst thing ever?
And to do so, you go to the Isla de Puna.
It's, oh God, that's right.
Oh, sorry, Isla de Puna.
Isla de Puna.
Which every time I hear one of those voice actors say.
Well, if it's anything like the original team, there was actually a lot of women on the team.
Yeah.
It's
not...
Oh, and that's the thing.
It's just so... off the cuff.
Yeah. And it's sort of like my appreciation goes both ways. Like, as much as I cringe at some of the stuff, I do genuinely enjoy a lot of the dialogue and the scenarios they put up. And the more ridiculous they are, the better it is, generally.
Because the whole thing's ridiculous.
Yeah.
It needs to stay at that level.
And I just do get at that point where I'm like, I've just liked this scene too much, and I'm now judging myself for that. So Honey Pop 2, I think it's a good follow-up to the first one.
I've been playing it on iPad with Steam Link, and even though it's not technically optimized for it, it still works okay.
I did the same thing on my phone, a little bit too small for it, just for the interface, but it still worked.
Yeah.
And, I mean, it's not... Most of the puzzles aren't time-based, so you can just take your own time. Yeah.
Sometimes
it.
You really want to take time and figure it out.
Too. Yeah, I feel like there's a core understanding of the mechanics that still hasn't clicked into my brain.
The ending sequence took me 35 attempts. It wasn't.
I remember the end
not
of Honey.
By the end.
The end of Honey Pop 1, I remember being quite hard too, but I don't remember it ramping up quite so quickly.
Mm. Yeah, like this one, I feel like is expecting you to have, like, basically, if you're interested in this one, don't play it.
Play the
other
one.
You haven't played the first one. Because first one is still fantastic. And then this is a continuation.
I will say, the other thing I enjoyed that they've changed from the first one is I'm glad I no longer have to keep a spreadsheet of what all the answers to every girl's questions are, so that when they ask me about it, I have to get the right answer.
Oh, I forgot all about that.
I never needed a spreadsheet for it. Like, I managed to get
through
it.
He was just that much
of a
Casanova.
You're just good at remembering what girls like, I guess.
I guess so.
what their favorite season and where they went to school and what they like to do in their off
time.
Like
I never had to write anything
down. What their cup size is. Yeah. You're just memorizing it all.
I do find it interesting. It's like, because you have very, in the dialogue choices, very direct, very sexual responses to most things. And you're like, ah, this chick, she's it. I'm just going to be like, it's like, no, she's still not into that. Doesn't like that sort of talk. I'm like, oh, sorry. I think I went a bit too far with your fantasy. I'm sorry, madam. For adults only.
Yes.
And very mature babies.
You can tone on the censorship.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which I think shows you one artwork instead of the three that you can toggle between.
Yeah, and honestly, I mean, the drawings, whilst you can have your own debate about it, the rest of the content is as objectionable as the drawings are. So the censorship's not going to save you from Inna de Puna.
No. Smelly pussies.
And the smelly. Oh god, that's it. So in an update of the world's worst people. Us? No, we're fine. We're okay. There's so many worse than us these days. We don't even rank.
The bar is
very low. As long as we don't have to ask our wives about empathy, it's like, oh. Anyway, if you're Australian, you'll know what that's referring to. Okay, let's have a spin-off from the intro. Let's talk about our Resident Evil 8.
Yeah.
So, Resident Evil 8, there was a Resident Evil...
A bit of a segue event. Still, though.
There was.
What? Oh, I mean, okay, yeah. It is a thirsty fan base. So, Resident Evil 8 had a little showcase thing where they said, hey, game's coming out, look at it. It's real cool.
It reminded all this me stuff. Almost of scope of, like, PT.
Oh, no, I'm just talking about the showcase so far, not the game.
Oh, not the demo.
So they showed that. They also showed, hey, here's our new multiplayer game. It's basically the map from RE2, but it's a class-based multiplayer. It's cel-shaded, and it comes free with RE8. So please play it. Please play it. It's not going to do well. It could be fine, but it's not going to do well.
Probably not.
They always seem to... not always, but they keep trying for that gold, and I don't think RE is the place for it.
Mm.
It's not what people are coming to the franchise for. So yeah, it's basically a sequel to Resident Evil 4. It's in the same environment. There's Village, but it's all lots of new characters and lots of new story. They keep calling it Resident Evil Village, not Resident Evil 8, even though there's an 8 in the title.
It's also a sequel to 7.
Yes.
Directly.
It's a sequel to 7 and it's a sequel to 4.
Protagonist.
Yes.
Mm. Okay.
Yeah.
Because Chris was in 4 as well, wasn't he? He was the...
Leon was the
lead. Oh, was it lead. Leon, was
yeah,
it?
Okay. Leon was the lead in 4. My brain had to go quickly into Resident Evil lore. Like, what was the president's daughter yelling?
Went to that mind palace.
I went to my special area. And there's also a 10-foot tall vampire lady?
At least.
9'10", I believe.
9 foot 10. Yeah. They put out her...
The internet was so thirsty, they had to make an official tweet about how tall she was, yes. Including her shoes and hat, because that's very important.
Very important, yes. People have become quite enamored with the tall vampire lady.
I don't know why.
I mean, she seems fine.
Seems like the entire internet has a giant ass fetish now. But.
I mean, in the right mood, everyone has a giant ass fetish, yeah. I feel.
See, being a tiny man, I just get that.
Everything's a giant ass
permanently.
I stood next to this lamppost and suddenly... anyway, they also released a demo, which we played through. I think it was Maiden, they called it.
Yeah.
And it was more of a tech demo.
Which I still couldn't finish.
Yeah, there wasn't any combat in it.
I'm probably
the only
person who actually noped out of that game.
Yeah, because when I had it, I was just like, but it's like a 10-minute long thing.
See, I'd nope out of it too, which is why I watched someone else play it. You could make the screen smaller.
So you start in a little prison cell and you make your way out and go up into the house and everything looks pretty and you see a couple of vampire ladies and they're walking away. Then a vampire lady starts talking to you, say, I can see you. And then there's a door that needs an eyeball to open it and you find that eyeball in a cup for some reason.
Because Resident Evil?
In a ring in a cup.
And then the vampire lady grabs you at the end.
And I'm sure she stood around going, why is this person opening all my drawers? They're all empty.
The best thing about the opening the drawers is...
But only the third drawer.
Yeah. It's only the drawer on the right. I think it was on these tables, because it was the same table model. I guess they only rigged the right drawer to open. So everyone's just has an opening right drawer.
And they're all empty.
Yeah.
That's the bit that got me.
So my takeaway from the demo is I'll come round to Paul's place.
And we'll play it together.
Paul will play it.
And there is a release date, but I forgot to write it down. So let's find out if I write the words RE8 release date. Well, that's not right.
22nd of January does not sound correct.
That doesn't sound like, a month ago. No. 7th of May.
That sounds more right.
That sounds more accurate. Google, you've done me wrong. But second Google, you did me right. so that's not too far in the future. And we'll probably... I don't think they're going to do any VR support, though.
That's a
shame. Such a big thing in 7. Yeah.
But maybe they found hardly anyone used it.
Yeah.
Hey, maybe it feels better timed with PS5 VR. Or maybe they'll patch it in later.
Yeah, maybe.
Maybe that's good for, they can kind of do a bit of a semi-re-release. Like, they can get this first wave and then...
Hey, we've released VR. Come back and play our multiplayer, please.
Okay, I might take a little break and go see what's going on with this baby. And now for some news. Let's rush through a bunch of news because we can. We're here for a good time, not a long time. In fact, we'll be a shorter episode than usual, I believe. But that's all right because we'll still pack it full of the greatest things ever. Stadia!
That long-lived, amazing piece of technology.
Stadia is still around. Got rid of all of their internal development studios.
That's what I mean. The long-lived, amazing piece of technology.
So Stadia's cancelled all internal development. Any game that isn't coming out this year is gone. And there's two studios they spun up are dissolved.
I saw an article today that said that they announced this a week after praising all of their developers.
Yes, I saw that as well. They said, you guys are doing such great work.
That's not to say that they're not going to nix it. What they've done is still good.
So well, we can't release it to the public. We're going to cancel it all.
It's so just telling of how shit Google is and how they basically... They'll never get the game's marketplace unless someone new comes in and can control it. Because they... they've made this service and they made all these promises about the potential of things. Mm. But no third party is going to... exploit the potential until someone has shown sort of the way. Yeah. They haven't even shown a tech demo showing this stuff off.
So this
never going to go anywhere.
This to me is, and it's something I've seen in like the tech industry, which wants to dabble in games, mm-hmm. where they bring in Silicon Valley thinking.
Yep.
And Silicon Valley thinking works for Facebook, Twitter, other things.
I feel this is going to be a very similar point. Yeah, where I was going. Yeah.
And they thought, let's come in. We're going to be really lean, and we're going to do our MVP, and we're going to just get it working and get it out there and start getting money, and then we'll iterate on it. Doesn't work with games.
No.
It doesn't. You put it out, and if it's shit, just move on.
Yeah.
You can't just go, we're going to iterate on this over time and make it. Sorry.
Yeah. The whole data driven focus of almost everything else in tech just doesn't work in games.
And I think I can, because I transitioned from app development to game development, mm-hmm. and it took me a very long time to realize that, because on the surface, they're very similar, but it's actually a very different mindset. Because
an app has an objective.
Yes.
And if it can do that objective, even if it's got issues, it's accomplished its goal.
So,
and then you can iterate.
Yes, because generally you have an app will have some kind of thing, like some feature that you're aiming for. I don't think I've ever worked on a game which has been anywhere near what it is at the end than it was at the start. Inevitably, it is completely different.
Always change.
Even look at Sky. Sky Squadron started as a mobile, from behind and the plane.
Star Foxy thing.
Yeah. Now it's an arcade rail shooter. Even Astro started off as a beat-based Space Invaders thing. They always change. And Silicon Valley just seems to think, I don't know, let's just get the MVP out and make it work. And
at least from comments of people in there, they will said it was very much like working for Amazon, except without any resources.
Wow.
So that whole that mindset without giving them the money and resources behind it. It's like, okay, great. Yeah, no wonder. But they still apparently were doing good work.
It's such a shame, because remember when they announced Stadia?
We were very excited.
The potential
was huge.
Yeah, when we were thinking, especially leveraging into streaming culture, where someone could be playing it and you could just hit a button and jump into what they're and playing.
Some of the things they were claiming, I remember at the time, we were saying I don't know how they could have the data centers to hold as much data they're going to generate from this, and I think the fact that it never came to be might also hold that. But the general, especially just the streaming stuff, it's like a slam dunk in the current world. I might not get streamers, but I am not the major audience of people of games online.
Yeah.
The amount of kids that I walk around at the day, because I work at a school, and they're just talking about who they were watching last night. I'm like, play your own fucking games.
and if they could be watching a streamer and just hit a button
and play their game,
it does a quick save, spins up a new instance, and you fork off that play session. Suddenly you're going to have all these people that are going to be playing.
How big the rise in games that have, generated content with seeds, and it's like, I want to play on the same seed that the streamer's playing on. All that kind of thing.
Yep.
I want to have the same experience they're having. Yeah. Or follow
something that's attached to a streaming service, so they push a new game on the streaming services, the streamers play that, those people are subscribed to it so they can just boot it up immediately and get into it. You could just push everything through that environment. Data would love it. But they just never got up to that. Microsoft might be able to do it, especially if you go with Games of Gold and then xCloud.
But they lost. GeForce is pushing into Australia soon. I've been getting some emails about their Australian service for streaming. Though the sense of office is in WA, which makes me
the furthest point from all of the place.
Like I said, I assume the office is in WA, but the data centers are not.
I hope the data centers
are not. I assume they'll be in
WA.
Sydney or something like that.
That would be worrying.
The states are pretty close together, right?
We'll just put the data center in the furthest point away from everything on the planet. Who needs latency?
That's good work. That'd be good. Running through the rest of the news. Okay, Warner Brothers are dickheads. Moving on. They spent the last few years trying to get a patent, and it's now been authorized for the Nemesis system from the Shadow of Mordor and Shadow of Wardor series.
Does that mean they have to take it out of XCOM?
The exact system
is right.
Yeah,
patents are weird.
It is very weird, and the patent as it got through, and the Nemesis system is a system that lets generate stories from fighting enemies, and then builds grudges and lets more stuff coming through. It is written somewhat broadly, and broad writing can go both ways. It's like you can claim quite largely, but also you can get around it with minor changes sometimes. The problem is, you got to be willing to fight that if you think that they're going to challenge you on it. which is more than likely going to stop anyone really exploiting that concept.
It's the usual trick with it, right? It's the let's make it annoying to have to deal with so that no one does.
Did you know there was a software patent on Katamari?
Yes.
Yeah. I learned that because I was arguing with a guy once about software patents, and it was my example of something that wasn't patented, and then he pointed out it was. And I was
What's patented?
Okay, so the actual rolling up mechanic.
But that's just shark.
No, like the very specifics of how the ball is built. Yeah, like you can look at the patent, and it's like it's all about how it's being attached to the ball. And
There was that Steam.
It's very strange.
Yeah, some there was of the that stuff third like, party like, Steam game. I can't remember the name of. It was early Steam days. It was a Katamari ripoff.
Oh, World Ends With You.
Yes, that's the one. I wonder if they ran afoul or whether they just didn't care.
I just think they didn't care.
that's the way to be. The famous one, of course, was the mini games during loading screens.
Happy End of the World. World Ends With You. I think I got the name wrong.
One of them.
I think World Ends With You, I think, might be the Square Enix game.
Now I'm confused.
Yeah, I think... I'm pretty sure Elwood's View is the Square Enix one. I'm going to get this right.
Yeah, that's the Square Enix one.
I'm pretty sure it's like Happy End of the World, I think.
Because when you said it, it was close enough that I accepted it.
I thought I remembered the name of the cup.
It probably has the word world.
Yeah. Katamari PC ripoff.
Look, if we don't know what it is, then I'm sure they didn't even highlight one. I want to see how close it was.
Wonderful end of the world. I was very close.
Yeah. It's a definite ripoff. First lesson of that review. But that's all right. I remember enjoying that. Okay, let's move in. Yeah, so that. We never mentioned, because the Star Wars stuff had only just started when we did the last episode, but the last bit we didn't get on was they're doing an open world game at Ubisoft from the Division team.
Yeah, which I'm pretty keen on that.
Cool.
I enjoy Division. I enjoy Star Wars. I'd like it if they did something in, what's the new universe? High Republic?
Yeah.
Yeah. It'd be cool if they did High Republic.
Sweet man.
Use the Force.
God. They fired the worst actor from The Mandalorian.
They did.
When it was announced that she was fired for just being a repeated shit on social media, and that's the thing to remind her, it was repeated, she was warned multiple times. Yeah. But, I mean, whilst I didn't approve of what she said, my main reaction was like, excellent, I've been calling her a terrible actress since the first time she was on.
That's the thing, right? She got fired for stuff outside of the fact that she wasn't very good at the thing she was meant to be doing.
Yeah, I don't care.
I do love that there was a petition that rose up to replace her character with Don Cheadle.
Isn't she doing a movie now with Ben Shapiro?
Yeah, yes. That was her retaliation.
Well, good luck with that.
Oh, yeah, you sure showed us. Woo. If it's half as good as Atlas Shrugged, they'll be begging for money to make the second half, which is still the funniest thing that's ever happened.
I don't know the story.
Oh, so they were making Atlas Shrugged trilogy.
Yeah.
And the first one was such a financial flop that they had to crowdfund for the other ones.
Mm.
So, I mean, you know, Ayn Rand and like...
So. Oh, yes.
Please, money. Yeah. Money, please. I mean, that's how she lived her fucking life too. So, what do you know? It's a bit hypocritical. I've written here Sex with Keanu.
Yeah, Cyberpunk.
Cyberpunk released its mod tools, or some mod tools. The first things people did was start making sex mods with Keanu Reeves.
Which I feel like he'd be okay with.
Why wouldn't you?
Well,
he isn't.
Oh, he's not.
So Keanu is now, and this is something I found out through this happening. He explicitly in any movie contract or anything he does, he uses doubles even for kisses.
Oh, really?
He explicitly will not do any, like, what's the word? I don't know why I've lost
intimate.
Intimate actions.
Yeah.
In a movie.
Okay, I didn't know that.
And it's actually, someone pointed out to me, it's noticeable in the new Bill and Ted, like when they're both kissing their wives, it actually just cuts away from Keanu.
What a weird thing.
Apparently it's something to do about, like, him and his wife's relationship. Like, he wants it to be a private thing. So he just doesn't do it in movies.
I thought, didn't his wife pass on, or does he have a new wife, or I just lost
something like that.
I mean, yeah. I mean, like, yeah. He's obviously got some hang-up over it. It's just, when I say weird, so I just mean, like, it's such, like, it's a quite a unique situation.
I think would really push the buttons.
But isn't there
a
Johnny Silverhand sex scene in the game? No. You just don't see anything?
There isn't. Not that I found and not that I've seen anything about.
Anyway, yes. So yeah, they put out a thing, please don't make sex scenes with Keanu Reeves.
Just pick any of the other character models.
Please don't.
We put all these hot women in there, just use them. Yeah,
we don't want another bloody Beyond Two Souls Ellen Page situation. Please don't. Please don't find the secret Keanu Reeves penis file. Which they might find now, because then somebody hacked their servers, stole their source code, and started auctioning it off to bidders on
the
dark web.
For apparently a lot of money.
Mm.
I thought they only sold one so far, because they took Cyberpunk source code allegedly, an unreleased version of Witcher 3, and Gwent. I think they'd only sold Gwent so far.
They leaked Gwent.
Oh, they leaked
Gwent. Gwent got leaked publicly.
Because Gwent is the one that
the
seems
rest
like...
of it got sold privately. And whoever bought it under a condition that it couldn't be resold or given to anyone else.
You know, this is one of those, like... So, you're saying Gwent source code's out there?
Yeah.
Yes.
This is one of those, like, really ethically dubious things. Because I'm super curious. I always like looking at...
To see what it...
The source
like,
code from, like...
Dig
from, like yeah. But I really shouldn't.
Yep.
I really, really shouldn't. But I'm so curious.
That was a big thing of... people were saying, like, oh, if the Cyberpunk one leaks, then we'll just get community fixes. Yeah. Like, they'll just fix everything. Like they do with Skyrim.
Yeah. I mean...
Like...
Kind of to a degree.
It's going to happen anyway. It will just make their lives easier.
Yeah. But also, I mean, especially with it still being actively worked on, that's going to
be... it's a bit weird.
Yeah, you wouldn't want... Like... It's
but
just got a huge
It's
huge
what's happened
mess.
With every Bethesda game.
Yeah, that's because they're more abandoned.
But. But the whole source code being token, I didn't really see... Like, if I was to lose the source code to Sky, like, what? So what happens next? Like, someone's going to release the game?
Yeah. Well, that's the thing. It's like, what
Asset
the fuck do you do
will
with
get
the
hold of it?
Yeah. Other than making pirated versions that have very well integrated ransomware.
Yeah, that was my one thing. Yeah. And then it's like, you can do that anyway.
Yeah.
But it's just probably easier to accomplish and make it a little bit more
like,
hidden.
I understand the Gwent one, because Gwent is like an online game, and there's like, if you get the source code to it, then you can find exploits. And like that,
single player stuff?
If it's a single player game, I mean,
just IP at that
You're just going to make a really cool version of yourselves?
I don't really...
I'm going to hack in ray tracing before they do.
Yeah, like even if you're a big tech company that's like after their tech...
There's nothing...
You can't really use anything.
You can't use it, because if you could, they could check the source and see, no, you've stolen this from...
Even when you're looking at, like, the ZeniMax Oculus stuff with Carmack, and half of it was them basically claiming that he took the code in his head. Yeah. Some of it, they said he took it. They're like, oh, but that's... Because he thought about it when he worked for us. It's similar.
Oh, wow. Who would have guessed a programmer working on two very similar products wrote the same type of code? Because that's how we code.
This bubble sword works surprisingly similar.
No programmer's going to sit down with the solution in their head
I've already done something
gonna,
like this.
I'm not going to do this.
But I'm going to write it in a completely different way so that I don't get sued.
Generally, you write the same thing again, but better.
Or worse,
sometimes.
Not yet announced, but E3 happening this year is going to be a digital-only event.
15th to the 17th of
as
June?
As we'd expect. I don't think it's confirmed yet.
That's the dates that they had, like, penciled in.
So the big problem with it at the moment is that, you know, it's going to be a digital-only event, and they have... it's going to be several days long, starting from, like, 10 a.m. till 10 p.m. each day in, like, two-hour slots for publishers.
Okay.
But... they haven't really got anyone signed on to it yet.
But why does it exist?
That's the problem.
Yeah, I don't... Even pre-COVID, it was having a lot of troubles, right?
Yes. Yeah. So people go like, oh, it was cancelled last year because of COVID. It was in trouble before COVID hit. They lost their creative partners. A lot of people had pulled out.
It's pivoting to try and stay alive.
I know.
But it's kind of pivoting to what it's... competition is, which is Summer Games Fest, Jeff Keighley's thing these days. And what is the benefit of being at E3 these days when you can directly market to your audience online?
Yeah, if E3 is going digital only, why would you use that platform?
Especially since it's still six figures to be on in their lineup.
If you're Sony, why?
Sony already pulled out of E3.
Yeah.
Just do your own thing.
Yeah, we just do it in our own time. We don't have to drop all our marketing at one time at this time of year. Because, you know, the thing was E3 got a bunch of eyeballs on it. But at the end of the day, what is that actually accomplishing for your marketing? It's like you can just do a Nintendo thing and release and announce the game 2 months before it comes out, and it still goes to your audience. And what have you lost? You just haven't spent a few million dollars putting stuff together. So it'll be interesting to see. And I really, really hope that something happens, because E3 press conferences are one of my like highlights of the year. I love it. I get obsessed.
It's just nice
for like
to have it all in one head, too.
Yeah, it's nice. It's very invigorating for me as someone that's very obsessed about game news and game releases and what's happening. But I'm not a community that really, serving me doesn't really help them at all. I just like it.
Yeah.
So me, think of me.
E3, just for Paul.
Yeah, that's the new tagline. Just for Paul. Yes. Mass Effect Legendary Edition was announced, which is the trilogy altogether, or up to 4K, new textures, models, replacing a little bit of quality of life to Mass Effect 1 with some of the combat, but primarily it's untouched. They just have changed some of the models, like Femsheps now. It's consistent through the series.
Yeah, I think they've touched up some of the animations, haven't they, for Femsheps? So,
yeah, and they,
it's not just a male animation with a female rig. Yeah.
And they made a few changes. Like there was one that... it's like apparently a character talking about being assaulted and the camera's like looking at her ass.
Yep.
So they moved the camera.
People were annoyed about that.
And that made people angry. It's like, oh God.
Oh no, I want to stare at the
butt. How can you be invested in that? That model's been on the internet for... You can look at that ass as much as you want.
You can probably download the model.
Yes. It's really not important, and probably artistically wasn't a great choice originally. I was just like, really, what are we caring about? If you want purity, you go play the original game. Still available.
You can still go to Steam and,
really,
and grab it.
I found out the other day, you know there's a big thing about randomizers existing. There's a Mass Effect 1 randomizer.
Mm.
What it does is it randomizes all the stats on all the characters and all the face rigs on every character. So every character has that kind of like just
monster,
all of
monster
the
look.
Numbers on like where their eyeballs are, what they're like, all of those character creation settings are all random, and it looks ridiculous.
that sounds
and then I think they've like text to speech translated and back into English all of the text.
I still haven't watched all of the Star Wars I think it's the prequel trilogy that they did the Chinese version. English it. Yeah, some great clips from that. Awesome. I need to watch the whole thing. I think I have the whole thing somewhere. That's good. Okay, so Mass Effect coming out, and that's just for not everything but the Switch.
Yeah.
Because fuck yeah. I mean, maybe I'd even give it a chance on the Switch because I'm a Switch obsessive.
Yeah.
Anyway, there was a very funny story with Xbox Live pricing. They doubled it.
Oh, did they?
Yeah. They said if you want Xbox Live, this isn't gold. I mean, this is gold. Mm. This isn't like
it's not game pass. This is if you just
want the multiplayer. They doubled the price.
So is it now cheaper to have the Game Pass and Live?
It's almost Game Pass includes Live.
Yeah, that's what I mean.
So it's still slightly cheaper, I think, but barely. Like, it's basically on parity.
So they're trying to shift people.
They're trying
to
shift
Pass.
Everyone to Game Pass. And in the thing, they also announced that they would free to play games. Now you wouldn't need Live for,
which is good.
And you've never seen a company flip flop so quickly. I think it took like 5 hours or so until it was just a big apologies. And some people were like, oh, it's just a marketing stunt. Except they'd already started all the... They've already started created and mailed out the marketing materials.
Yeah. There's no way that'd be a marketing stunt.
No, not at all. That's not how it works. It's like
far
people
too
that,
much.
Yeah.
It's like people that think like the Sonic the Hedgehog design was like bad on purpose.
No.
It's like, no, that's not how any of this works. That would be such a waste of money.
It would.
Like, you could have just come up with something good originally and you wouldn't have to do the whole thing. It's just as effective. Anyway, so that was just a cute one. I like my phrasing sometimes. Blizzard ruined Vicarious Visions. Blizzard have taken one of my favorite port factory developers, Vicarious Visions, who have been doing solid work for about 30 years. Mm. Some of their mobile version of like Tony Hawk and stuff, really good. And they just did the Tony Hawk HD remake. They are even their shittiest games. The shitty part is the game that they're porting. Their work on it is almost always great.
Yeah.
So now they don't exist anymore. They've been absorbed into Blizzard because Blizzard got rid of their Team One, which used to be their A-list team. That it was like their prestige team, but that sort of shifted over the years, and they were responsible for Warcraft 3 Reforged, which, if you look into that, it was more them getting screwed over than them doing bad work. Yeah. So they don't exist anymore, and Vicarious Visions have been brought in allegedly. They've already were working on, but now are more in a We Are Blizzard capacity, working on Diablo 2 Remake. And now
they're not porting Overwatch into Overwatch 2.
That's not their job at the moment.
Someone's already doing that.
But they'll be pulled into that. So Vicarious Vision is gone, and now they're just another part of Blizzard, and they'll be working on Blizzard products from now on.
Awesome.
Yeah. I think Blizzard are probably what it means is we'll just see more decent remasters of their old stuff.
But they've already remastered everything. What else is there? Diablo 2.
We're going to get Blackthorn. Warcraft 2, Blackthorn, Lost Vikings.
Uh-huh. Rock and Roll Racing. Yeah, Rock and Roll Racing was. Yeah,
they could do a really good Rock and Roll Racing.
I would like that.
Do you take it back?
If they do Rock and Roll Racing, I will take it back.
God, I hope they do. Dragon is vicious Rock and Roll Racing.
It'd be fucking great. Soundtrack would be kicking. Okay, speaking of remasters, GoldenEye for Xbox 360 was leaked. Because they were making it. I think Rare was actually just doing it themselves. And it was almost complete. And just the legals hadn't finished doing all the checking that they could make it. And then...
No one called the Bond company.
Yeah. Bond was all right. Apparently Nintendo was the ones that...
Ah.
And most of them were fine with it as well. Yeah. Apparently one person at Nintendo, we just don't know who, was just like... That game's never going on a fucking Xbox. no GoldenEye. But the game is leaked now. It's not quite the version that they got up to, because apparently at the end when it got canned, their bug list was 90. It's like, there are 90 bugs left in this product, which is pretty fucking low.
Under 100 is solid.
I just ship that.
Yeah, very close to completion.
As long as none of them are game-breaking, it's good to go.
This is apparently just like one or two versions before that. It's pretty much completely playthroughable. If you know how to play those things, it is accessible, and you can go watch people play through it. I don't have any ethical qualms. I don't give a shit. Go and watch that stuff. It's fine. It's an interesting artifact that will never be available commercially. So, have a look. It's a great piece of history. GoldenEye is a weird game made by people that didn't know what they were doing, and they accidentally made a classic.
Yeah.
I mean, like, you remember the multiplayer in that?
Yep.
Yeah. I think it was 2 weeks.
Yep.
And then we're supposed to do it. They hacked it in the last 2 weeks. And said, "Oh, this could work." Yeah,
they're like, "Maybe we should do this.
Yeah,
let's give it a go." Yeah.
So yeah, all of GoldenEye.
And it's the only thing most people remember about GoldenEye.
Okay. We have three Gearbox stories, all contained in one line on my notes here. Gearbox have been bought by Embracer Group.
Yeah, so did either of you, when you saw this headline or article or anything about it, go, who?
Yeah, I had no idea.
Who are these people that just bought Gearbox?
Also, the news that same week was Embracer Group, now the largest publisher in Europe.
Yeah.
See, I just assumed that they were just one of these like four megacorps that actually own the world.
Yeah, pretty much. Like, we've never heard of them, but now we have.
Yeah.
Well,
turns out they own everything that we don't like.
Oh, no, they own everything I like. When I start looking into it, I'm like... Like, for instance, they own Coffee Stain, which is...
Oh, really?
Deep Rock Galactic, they own Satisfactory,
that changes
Valheim, which everyone is playing now. They own...
So they are. They're the Megacorp.
They're one of the Megacorps. Yeah, okay. Embracer, which is a perfect dystopian sort of name. It's like, come to Embracer. Feel the love.
We will embrace you with our money.
Yeah, as they, like, squish you in, and your bones liquefy and you're absorbed into the massive Embracer. And then another voice joins Legion.
And you hear, do you want to see a card trick?
Anyway, so they got bought by Embracer. I'm like, awesome. Randy must have sold it. Randy's gone. No, Randy's just as rich as ever. He's more rich now because it was I can't remember how much money it was for now. But
it was a chunk.
But does Randy now have oversight?
Yes, and Randy has some power at Embracer now. And I'll say it again. Randy is quite a dickhead, but if he wants to invite me to his mansion for a magic night, I will attend.
I'm not a proud man. You physically cannot say no to that kind of...
It's pretty good. Okay, Then second part of it, Battleborn servers have been turned off. Can't play Battleborn anymore.
Those four people are very disappointed.
Sorry, Randy. He's the only.
I wonder if that was just in the like legal contract.
They said we'll only buy you if you turn this shit off.
Turn off Battleborn.
And finally, news on the Borderlands movie casting. So Borderlands the film, directed by Eli Roth of Cabin Fever fame and Hostel. Starring Kevin Hart as Randall, the tall, quiet man.
The tall, quiet, stoic leader man.
Perfect casting. Also, we have Jamie Lee Curtis as Dr. Something.
Oh, yeah. Oh, I forgot her name, but...
Yeah.
I think that's an okay
Look. With the exception of Eli Roth, who I actually don't... Like, some people really hate Eli Roth. I'm, like, fine with him. He's done some movies that I enjoy and other stuff that's, like, whatever. But I don't necessarily see him as, like, a super creative director. He's just a guy that can just... He can point a camera fine. Cate Blanchett is... Siren...
Lilith.
Yeah, Lilith. And Jack Black as Claptrap.
Which is probably the solid choice.
It's a half recreation of Jumanji at this point. But yeah, I don't know the tone of this movie's going to be.
First off, I did see your comment to that person who was like, "It's a 3D robot. Why didn't they just get the voice actor to do it?"
Oh yeah. And my comments, you mean the guy Randy told to fuck off when he asked to be paid correctly?
Yeah, I got a good laugh after seeing that pop up. The second thing is that it's the Borderlands film, and they are going the route for video game films of going, well, that story, fuck it.
So
fuck that story.
So, like, there's no Handsome Jack?
I don't know if there'll be Handsome Jack or not. So, the storyline they're going with is Lilith, in the game, the siren vault hunter, is a down-on-her-luck thief who is hired to rescue... one of the billionaire megacorp's daughters, which is Tiny Tina now.
Tiny Tina, is it?
Yeah.
Okay. That's going to please a lot of people.
From being captured and held to ransom. And so she gets a team of vault hunters together to help her out. That's the storyline,
so
as far as
I'm aware.
So why
are they going for vaults? Yeah, why are they still called
vault
hunters?
So there's no hunting for vaults?
There's no vault to be hunted?
But they are vault hunters still?
Look, I will assume that there will be a vault somewhere involved in this somewhere.
I imagine they're holding her to ransom in a vault.
You know, I found on Facebook Marketplace this week someone selling a bank vault door.
Oh, yeah.
And I'm like,
maybe.
Like, so I could put that on the front of my little weird dungeon downstairs.
Yeah.
I mean, I assume it's like several tons. So I'm not quite sure how I transport it, but it was free. It just said free, must remove with own tools.
So my only hope now is obviously they've picked and gone, here's a bunch of characters from a video game. Let's throw a story together. So now I just hope that the next announcement is that they're going full Scanner Darkly and rotoscoping it.
Well, that's what I was wondering. Will they go like...
just rotoscope
style?
The whole thing.
That's the thing.
Just go all the way.
The primary... like
the pull for Borderlands
is
the art style.
Well,
even
with the cosplay is about replicating
that
style. That cel-shading art style.
No one does it without... Yeah. Well, it's not cel shaded. Oh,
yeah. Fake cel shaded.
But I mean, like, remember when Borderlands was announced and it wasn't cel shaded?
Yes, and it just looked like a muddy shooter.
Yeah, and everyone was like, "This, who gives a fuck?"
Yeah. It's just a muddy shooter.
Once they found that look, which they stole from that artist, apparently, it was like, that's what it is. And then that cool Cage the Elephant song.
Yeah, and then
because
it's the three things. It's using those songs. It's the cel shading, and it's the let's just make lots of meme jokes and stupid jokes and humor and like that's three things you can't put in other than the songs. I guess
the audience, the big Borderlands fans, I didn't think they're there for the epic story.
No.
So
certainly,
they're there for the mindless shooting and the getting of loot. And
maybe then it doesn't matter.
Yeah,
I don't think it.
That's the thing.
Oh,
if
I'm not clutching my pearls.
If you're going to pick anything to just make a new story for, it's a good one to pick. But I do, in my heart, wish that they just rotoscope the whole thing.
Yeah,
that would be good. Okay, I love Scanner Darkly.
Yeah, it's so good.
So good.
But they won't.
They won't. No. It'll just be a they could. Regular old what if heist
what if
movie.
They only do outlines? Just
they just run a photo filter over.
I tell you what,
posterize everything.
Yeah, if they did just like real films, but then everything was given comic book outlines, that would be a look I have not seen before, and it would be wild.
But they won't. It's just going to be safe.
No, and let's be.
And look, it's going to look a bit like they're going to have
Jack Black will make some stupid jokes.
They're going to have some bright colored clothes. There'll be colors in there somewhere. They'll be kind of dirty.
Do you think Kevin Hart's first appearance is going to be like this big imposing shadow comes in and then like the camera pans? He's like, "Hey, down here."
Probably.
They digitally make him half the size. I'm a little man, but I got a big gun. And then, like, the music kicks in, but it's for some reason it's Skrillex. And I'm like, oh, okay.
And they focus tested it and found out Skrillex did better.
You know, even though I just made the joke, I like Skrillex.
Yeah.
It's fine. It was of its time.
It's perfectly good, kind of not dubstep.
Yeah. Just wait, it's not dubstep?
Not if you ask people who like dubstep, apparently.
Well, I certainly claim no expertise in this field.
I don't understand any of it.
Yeah. I mean, maybe he's the Susan Boyle of dubstep. Very impressive if you don't really know much about the genre, but otherwise, yeah, you know, it's a fun story. speaking of casting, The Last of Us TV show has had its cast announced, or at least its leads announced.
I'm on board with this casting.
Yes, Pedro, last name?
Pascal,
from Game of Thrones and Mandalorian fame, is our Joel. And our girl who played that Mometka.
the girl that everyone loved from Game of Thrones. The little bear queen.
Monment. What's a Monment? Monment. Yeah. But her actual name, I suppose I should actually look it up. Yeah,
probably.
This is what I get for not
I think
right
those
now.
Are two good casts.
Yeah, and like, I didn't realize at first it was an HBO series.
Yeah.
Yeah, you thought it was a movie, right?
Yeah, I thought it was going to be a movie, and heard HBO series, like, yeah, that actually makes a lot of sense. Like, I think this is going to work well.
Yeah, and I don't... Bella Ramsey is her name, the young actress. And she certainly, like, while her character didn't do that much in Game of Thrones, became quite memey, she did a very good job of it. Yeah. It was fine. I expect it will be very good, and I don't know if I really care about watching that format, but we'll find out. I'm a little bit disappointed that it's just so solid, that it's like there's no left wing things like to take me off by the to really surprise me. It's like, ah, oh, so you've hired good writers and directors and good cast. And like,
do something crazy.
Yeah, it's like when the Monster Hunter was coming out and like it's getting like 1 out of 10 reviews and we're like, fuck yes! Cannot wait. It's going to be everything we ever wanted. We'll actually get up to that later, I think. Let's just get through. Hogwarts has been delayed.
Of course.
The Prince of Persia remake has been delayed. Indefinitely. Which just means they haven't announced
it. I looked up the definition of indefinitely, and by definition, it was not defined. So yes. It was like the most technically correct clickbaity title.
Anthem, this week, it has not been announced yet, but it was getting assessed. They're gonna come in and they're going to go like, we're either going to expand the team to fix it, we're happy with what you're doing, or we're going to just cut our... losses and move on.
I would put money still have
on the second.
On the second,
still have both sealed copies that Cal bought.
Yes, I've still got it.
Yes, me too. Just
holding on to it.
We should get it. We should get in there.
In case it becomes a gem.
Have a good Anthem day.
It's a very bad video game.
It's not. I liked the shooting and the flying.
But those are two of the things that are bad about it.
No. The shooting and the flying are fine as a whole.
It is not a good.
It is not a good video game. No.
Yeah, but I only played it for half an hour and I just shot and fired at that time.
I
was good.
Finished it.
You what? I don't remember this.
It's a terrible game. Yeah.
No,
it's finished.
I've played it through.
Why?
Because I needed to.
You like the shooting?
I needed to hate play it.
You like the shooting? Like the Steam reviews, there's like 1,000 hours in this game and the review's like, well, it's not that great.
like there's a bit in the middle. Like the bit like the where,
there's
where
a bit in the middle.
Where they had they needed to make the game artificially longer. And so they put in this grindy thing. Where you have to do certain things which require other players to be there, which because someone's
really
playing.
I remember that stuff.
There's this whole bit in the middle where it's like, oh shit, the game's too short. Let's just like put in these like busy work, and like you're expecting like, oh okay, I'm gonna like you're meant to go to these tombs, and you're expecting like maybe you go to this tomb and it'll be like this area of like oh like a Zelda dungeon or something. Like, something cool's gonna happen. Yeah. No, you just walk in and go, here's the item. Like, it was like literally just these tasks they put in. It's a bad video game.
Quests.
It's bad.
I'll have to find the tune.
Like, and as a looter shooter, it was terrible.
Schluter.
But this is the reason I finished it, because this is back prime James playing Destiny.
Mm-hmm.
Like, so it's like, ah, oh, looter shooter and BioWare. So
it's got to be okay.
It's
right?
I got to do this. No. Good facial animation though.
Yeah.
Well, nice. that rescues the whole project there. Yeah.
Had some good performances. The people were fine.
Kingdom Hearts is coming to PC.
Yeah.
Hell yeah.
And you can get all the packages. You could get Kingdom Hearts HD 1.5 plus 2.5 remix, then Kingdom Hearts HD 2.8 final chapter prologue, and then Kingdom Hearts 3 plus Remind, and of course Kingdom Hearts Melody of Memory, which just sounds like a video game title, that last one.
So I picked up Kingdom Hearts 3 for about $10.
Yeah.
And because I thought, I played Kingdom Hearts 1, I didn't really like it that much, but I liked the universe.
Mm.
But I thought, okay, look, let's jump into this.
One,
I think I played three. I think I played a little bit of two. I at least played like the Sora stuff, and then I got very confused.
What about the fractured ones on the 3DS?
The 3DS ones that have like required lore and story.
I've seen the summary. I've seen the circle,
the Venn diagram.
I started playing it. And I did the tutorial, and about the point it lost me was I played through, like, it's not that long, like just the basic tutorial stuff, and then it brings up the title card of like Kingdom Hearts 2.8.
Yeah.
Just wait, so you thought 3 was 2.8?
3. I'm playing 3. The title card was 2.8.
Yeah.
And I was like, you know what, Kingdom Hearts, I'm done.
I don't understand why the first package is 1.5 plus 2.5, but the next one is 2.8, which is apparently 3 that you're playing, but there is Kingdom Hearts 3.
Welcome to Kingdom Hearts, Paul, where you actually have to go and read probably a master's degree paper.
This is my worry. This is my worry about Final Fantasy VII Remake.
Yes.
That eventually, like in 20 years, it's still going to be going. It's
Final, convoluted.
Final Fantasy VII point, like the near...
the near replicant.
Replicant subtitle. Yeah. With those long string of...
Kingdom Hearts has really been a weird one. And like, it's one of the few series where every time I see what it is, I just forget what the order is and what each number means.
Yeah. And
I've Evangelion, understand. Like the Evangelion movies where it's like 1.11, 2.22, 3.33.
I stopped long before.
And the next one is 3.0 plus 4.... whatever the next one's called.
I watched a random episode of Ava the other day.
Yeah.
It holds up really well.
The original show.
It's very strange
still.
Like I was watching it and like I thought that it'd be very of its time. But no, it is a well-made show.
I'm just a fully cootie man, although I still haven't watched season 2 or 3.
Oh, no, I haven't either.
No, I feel like it's just not going to...
I don't think I need them.
Two bits. So, prepare to feel old. What is it, 20 years since?
Since what, fully cootie?
No, I mean, probably.
It probably is.
It's for internet culture related.
Yeah.
Since the first memes of All Your Base Belong to Us.
Oh, yes, I saw that.
Zero Wing. It's 20 years since we first put on
the bomb.
Yep, on the Something Awful Forums.
Moving the Zigs.
Yep. The song that we mostly know that came a little bit after this, but that's when the meme started. But here's my big news. Remember 6 Days of Fallujah?
Oh, is this the Iraq War thing?
Yeah. That was, well, I can't remember the year now. It was announced and everyone said, that's a terrible idea. That's like, happened like last year. It's a war crime. And like, oh, right. I think Konami was publishing at the time. And they said, right, we shouldn't publish that. And they cancelled the game. It's back.
So we finally figured out how long you have to wait after
after a war crime until you can make a fun video game about it. Yeah. Well, you'll be happy to know this about this time in Fallujah where it's period of 6 days where big battles happened and people got killed with white phosphorus. You'll be happy to know that it's going to be non-political.
Oh,
that's good. So they've announced that, haven't they?
Yes, they put out a big announcement saying that it's going to be non-political in our war crime game. So that's going to be a real journey watching that game come out now. It's different developer. Some of the people, because it's two of the people are like ex-Halo people.
Okay.
But then otherwise it's... I don't know who they are. Yeah. weird thing to pull back. It's like I assume they're just using the license because it had some notoriety, so you can get some press. But it's not good press.
No.
I just can't imagine, because they did do a talk where it's like, you know, they want games to be mature, which is then weird to say it's going to be non-political, because how the hell
can you have that be mature and not?
I think it's because people have a weird concept of what political is. Like, well, we don't say the words Republican and Democrat. It's like, yeah, that's not what that fucking
means. We're not commenting
means.
On the current political state.
Yeah,
exactly. So it's fine.
It's like, I don't think games, especially big budget shooters, are anywhere near the finesse to be able to deal with shit like this. Like, Spec Ops The Line does it the best for that sort of thing. And even that, I don't think really lands it for most of the gameplay. Yeah. It's just, it gets better.
Well, and it's also using the genre to kind of make a point.
Yes. But it's still weird that it's a fun shooty game.
Yeah.
Cool. So that's all I basically had as news. So, we better talk about the other big game before we work out when we're actually ending this episode. Valheim is now one of the biggest launches in Steam history.
Just snuck up there.
2 million in the first week. And you probably, unless you are in for that, you've probably never heard of it before, because I ain't heard of it before it came out. It's a survival Viking game. And you are... someone that's better with the lore would do this better than me, but yes, you're sort of in between death. You haven't gone to Valhalla.
You're thrown down from Midgar, is it?
Yeah, you're
like
underneath the world tree. You can look up and see the roots above you. And it's an interesting mix. So, it is a survival game through and through. You go up to... Well, you can't just go up to a tree and hit it, because you're not strong enough to hit a tree, but you can go up to a branch and hit it.
Yeah, you can do a twig.
Yeah, go get a twig. Go get a twig. Build yourself an axe. Well, you gotta pick up a stone too. Now you can cut down a tree. Cut that tree up. Best thing
you
about
can
trees.
Let that tree hit of a tree.
I think. What's so far what's set apart for me from other survival games is that it feels like there's much more of a PvE focus in this one.
Yeah.
Where like there is a button in there.
Ark
to go,
and Rust are very like.
Yeah. I
make your what, own what it, fun with what
it,
other people.
Yeah. What it looks like. I mean, I think you've played it.
Probably so more
quite
than
a
you.
Lot. Quite a lot.
Than me. We've beat the first boss, and we've been fucking around for a good few hours.
But just the initial impression for me is like, and the reason why I feel like it's getting the traction it is it something like Rust or Ark? There's a degree of toxicity around the PvP aspect, which is part of the game. It's fine, like it's there. Or Conan Exiles, which is like I think the last survival game I played, where it's like, you know, yes, someone can come in and kill you and take your shit, and that's kind of part of what the game is. I feel like this one they've kind of pulled back on that. And tried to make it more about...
There are certainly public servers. You can certainly go in and wreck other people's stuff up.
But that isn't the...
It's not the point.
The point, yeah.
And we... My group, that's normally my Deep Rock Galactic group, we've rolled up a dedicated server. So that's another nice thing. You can have a server that's just running all the time.
Had you spin it up?
You have to ask Adam.
Oh, okay.
But the instructions are just like in a text file. It wasn't hard.
Yeah.
And in fact, we didn't get it working on the first night. And after the first night, we took the save file of the world
and just pushed it onto the
server. We use that as a dedicated server. So you can do that.
Okay. And you can also take characters between.
Yeah. So your characters are persistent. So what's on them? So, like, if you had stuff that you left on another server, that's on that server. But if you have stuff in your pockets, you take that with you. But you can take your character anywhere. There's progression through it. It does the old Elder Scrolls thing where I'm just going to jump a lot and I'll get better at jumping.
I did like that when I saw it. I'm like, doing things.
Yeah. It's crafting. I quite like in that you pick up a new item, some wood, some leaves or whatever, and it immediately just gives you all the recipes that you can do with it. So it's not a bunch of trial and error putting stuff together. It's like, no, you've got a bunch of metal and you can make a helmet. It's fine. The structure is basically you need to kill a bunch of creatures to sort of show your worth. And there's basically an order to it, and you'll find them, summon them, have a boss fight. Then you stick their head back in a stone circle. And for each one you do, you get a Breath of the Wind Wild Guardian power that you can use once every 20 minutes. Yay! on top of that, like, the building is pretty good. It's got like a good snap too, but it's also not that snap too.
Well, yeah, I found that when I was...
It snaps, but boy, you can build on angles.
Like I just found one of the like
pre-existing places.
Yeah, I was like, rather than building my own, I'm just going to repair one that's there. And it's like, there's a 45 degree slope and there's like a 27 degree slope.
Yeah.
And I didn't realize that. And so I'm trying to put this 27 degree thing on like a 45 degree. Like, why is this? This is so awkward.
This doesn't look right.
But the snapping, that when I figured it out, like, oh, okay, it's still a little bit clunky. But,
and you also have, it also has some basic physics to it. So,
yeah, like that. Like if you try to build too much of wood, your house will collapse.
Yes.
Under its own weight.
Yeah. So you need to actually put in supporting beams and columns and all that.
It's got a lot of systems like that too. Like, the entire smoke inhalation, if you don't
vent your fire smoke away.
And,
yeah, you can choke on your own fire in your sleep. But so it's also like, it's not like a crazy system. It's like, I can see the smoke billowing in this building. I better open a fucking window.
Yeah.
It's very straightforward with that
or
sort of stuff.
Or if someone's sleeping in there, can you then go and close the border up?
I should
put a fire in the house, close it off.
I don't think you can sleep unless everyone's sleeping.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So. Oh, no, I guess someone has to sleep first.
Yeah. You just wait. Surely it's like Minecraft, right? Yeah. Where you're just in the bed waiting for someone.
Yeah, waiting for... Because, once everyone goes to sleep in a bed, then it just fast forwards to the next day. It's really good. I think probably also what sets it apart... is it's pretty solid.
Like, because it's early access, but...
It's early access, it's survival game, which hasn't been a bunch of janky shit.
I noticed with it too, like, it's taken away a lot of the shit you get bogged down in survival games and made it a lot easier to focus on the fun parts of a survival game. It's like, there's a food system, but if you don't eat it, you're not going to just die.
Yeah,
it's like
the
weapons degrade with use, but you don't have to constantly use resources to
So
you can repair stuff for free, right?
You build a workstation inside a building and you just walk up to it and you hit the repair button and all your stuff repairs.
So once you build an axe, you just have an axe forever.
Yeah, you don't have to keep making axes all the time.
There's no resource sink for all the stuff.
The only time that I had to build a second axe because I was out chopping wood and my first axe broke and I wasn't anywhere near thing. I'm like, I have wood and a stone, so I'll just make another axe. And then I threw it away.
But then like the food system is more strategic than it is about survival. Like all that, it's all those things that like technically make a survival game survival. But also, like, you spend half your time playing having to deal with.
So, you never have to eat food. You've got, at least at the beginning, I don't know if you get more, but you've got 3 slots to eat. You can't eat more than one of the same things. Yeah. You can't just get a bunch of berries and eat 3 berries. You could have to eat 3 different foods, and they'll give you health and stamina extra on what you normally have. And they work out over time. And when you don't have them, it's still
dependent on the food, too. Yes, so each food will give you, like, a different amount of health or stamina. Yeah.
You cook food and, sort of all your standard stuff, except it all just sort of works and it's relatively intuitive. The systems aren't too wild. We go out hunting. I quite like that. So on the Monday night, we had a go hunt the first boss. We did that. Then everyone's just been popping into the server and I popped in and I went exploring and I found sort of an ocean and I know we can make a raft. So I'm like, I'm going to build a second encampment next to the ocean. So I'm just there building a little house. Then 2 friends that I didn't even realize were on the server run past. I'm like, hey, what you doing? I'm like, oh, I'm building this. We're out hunting deer. I'm like, oh, great. Well, I'll just put some beds in a crate in here if you want to dump gear and resupply. So then they started using my base as the going off point because it was a good hunting area. And it's like, this is just a nice... And then, so one of the good tricks is when you find, you can find little settlements that are destroyed. Excellent ways to harvest wood. Screw trees. Just go and take all the walls from another place. So I'm just there going slowly walking through with my hammer Suddenly the guys run up because there'd be some deer around me and everything. Didn't realize behind them was a big troll. So suddenly we just had this big battle in this half destroyed village and I got a bunch of troll drops. I'm like, I've got all these recipes now. Gotta go finish my sea shanty.
It actually kind of surprises me a bit that this hasn't been made already. Like when we've had so many survival games and they've all been derivative of like this iterating like on the same thing. Probably what's the most recent one I can think of, maybe Conan.
Rust is back in fashion at the moment.
Yeah, Rust is popular now, but like it just seems like no point in anyone say, well, how can we take this like really hardcore survival thing and let's knock it back a notch.
Yeah.
Let's look at like where Minecraft is and we'll just sort
find
of like
the middle ground.
Hey, let's just go back here, let's just go back about a third and try and soften it up a bit.
And like it's somewhat realistically based, so it's not, you're not going to go weird and crazy like Minecraft.
Because I think
anything.
Like there was Grounded, but I feel like Grounded was more of like a story game where they've kind of like injected some survival stuff into
it. Yeah, and also Grounded is just still so basic. Like it is nowhere near this as a game in its early access.
Where I feel like this is like like there'll be emergent things that happen. Like you were talking about, you've got your little camp. Well, yeah. Maybe now other people are going to build other things around there, and suddenly a little town forming. And,
well, that's because we're going to let a few other little people into the server, I think, which I haven't sent you. I've got to get clearance from the people that run it. Because we don't know what we're doing yet.
Yeah. Got a white list,
because James. Because you can come in and just screw everything up.
Mess up the fun. Yeah.
But also, I mean, that's kind of... Because, you know, if you do just have people running around being... If you had, like, two settlements and then every once in a while your story's intersected, that'd be cool. The only problem is that the story progression, which is killing those bosses and everything, that is server-based.
Yeah.
So, our rule would be...
You kind of have to be at the same base.
You can't fight a boss except for Monday nights when we all go on the server. But you can do everything else because there's dungeons and stuff. Yeah. There's a lot there. Mm. It looks really nice too.
I really like the art style. Yeah. They've got that kind of like that pixelated texture work going on it.
Which I don't really know where that originated. Like everyone's also goes like, oh, you know, it's a bit like PS2-y or something. Like, have you looked at a PS2 game? No, it's not.
No, because it's like
PS2's just low poly.
If anything, it's like it's un-texture filtered Quake 2.
Yeah, maybe.
It's like pre-3D accelerated Quake
on top
2.
Of it. Just such lovely like effect work and like the way the trees move. Like you get, because first when we started, it was so foggy you could barely see anything, and then like one day the fog just lifts off the ground because it's all volumetric and looking beautiful. It's like, and we could see the tree roots above us, and it was a bright, beautiful day. And the draw distance was huge, and the forest, they got very good forests. They feel thick. They feel like old forests, and you're running through them and like. You're stopping just now just to check, is there movement over there? Is there a deer that we can get? And get that goddamn deer. Yeah, deer's a good.
It's what I like when they do these kind of like retro throwbacks in art style, where it's not just trying to mimic what it was.
No,
it's like bring in like, we want to have nice grass. We want to have like nice physics interaction. Like if you knock over a tree, the log's going to roll nicely down.
Oh, yeah.
And,
well,
you know, like,
we mentioned that they knock out over trees, but they're also one of the most deadly things in the game.
If you're gonna die,
the only thing that's killed me in this game is trees.
Which is fair.
Yeah. A tree falling
pretty legitimate.
Very dangerous things. Yeah.
But I also think like styles like that are for, you know, a small team. It's like they've worked out something that they can sort of make assets pretty well at that level of detail, both texture and poly-wise. But they haven't really compromised on it looking... They didn't make it look bad. They just said,
no.
What style can we create that we can reiterate on quickly and make more content? Because we want lots of content for a game like this. But still looks really... Like, you sit and you sit in those fields and you... It looks great. The animation's great. The animals running around. Like, it's as pretty as any other game I've played. Just technically, when you look at it, it's like, oh, I guess that's low poly. And there's... It's just a bunch of blocks on that texture. Yeah. That's fine.
They've got their...
That's smart
art. 16x16K texture. Oh, sorry, 16x16 pixel
makes
texture.
Makes for a very, very small pixel install
texture.
Size.
Yeah. It's well, like 400 meg. Yeah.
Well, because the textures on everything will literally be like probably like 16x16 pixels. So they're just sort of like... And that's how they get that kind of blocky thing.
It's
the
tiny install size.
Now, to speak a little bit of inside baseball at that, our current time, James, are we wanting to wrap up the show?
I did say I'd be leaving about 9.
Okay.
Because
I've got a few other things to talk about. They're kind of big. I can do one very quickly.
Yeah.
I got Gorn on the Oculus Rift. And you know what makes Gorn much, much better? Not having to use the in-game locomotion and just using a big room. Oh, it's so good. Well, because Gorn, if you've never played it, is a gladiatorial combat game. It's very cartoony. Now, if you look at the Oculus Quest version... And you look at the PC version. PC version looks very, very nice. A very big, beautifully modeled, chunky man going, yelling at you. Oculus, man, much lower poly. Lighting's not as good. You know what? Don't give a shit after about 30 seconds. Yeah. It still runs at a really good pace. But the fact that I can just take the headset to a bigger place, and because it's weird. In Gorn, you either have to use the stick to move, or you sort of like do the grab the world thing. You're like, oh, I'm moving my arms and I'm pulling myself around. But when you're just running back and forth and hitting people with a big hammer, oh, it's so fun. It's like, it really hammers in. Like, I mean, it's like the Nintendo thing. It's like, you know, we've always said for years, like that graphical fidelity doesn't really matter much. But it's the experience of
immersion and experience matter the most,
I care at all. It is so much a better version of the game. And yes, you could run the PC version with a Quest and run it through...
Virtual desktop.
Whatever
it's called. Yeah.
And, you know, if you want higher fidelity, that's good. But to play it untethered in a bigger room, that's how that game should be played. And it is... you know, you start just getting wacky and silly. And that's what it's for. I mean, it really, the game's not that hard on the whole. I mean, it does keep ramping up the difficulty as you get through waves. But it is about being creative with stuff. It's about how can I bash this person's head in a very funny way. Very gory too, which I enjoy. I like knocking out an eyeball or two. But that's my very quick cover, because I'm pretty sure I've covered Gorn when it first came out. It's a quality game and made even better on the Quest, I think.
Many things are once you're untethered.
Yeah, I do. I do like the Quest a lot still. And I don't get to play it as much as anymore. I feel like having a baby, you feel like downtime. You get quite a little
eyes.
Yeah, you feel like you just can't disconnect quite as much.
Yeah, I don't think I've only used the Quest for work since you've had Roger.
You need to stay in the real world when you have a baby.
Like, there's always this like, this thing where when I'm having downtime, it's like, do I do something fun? Or do I sleep? and the sleep part's important too.
Especially at your point, I'd probably say
Most of the time, the answer is
get sleep.
Sleep when you can. It's like, okay, I got like an hour. I really want to check out something, but oh God, I need to sleep. I got to lunch today. And I was like, okay, I'm just going to, like, I'm pretty tired. I've been working this morning. I'm just going to like sleep through lunch. I just woke up at 2. Like, it just like totally just like crashed for like 2 hours.
That's the way it goes.
Yep.
We'll have to save our Monster Hunter review for another time. Wait, I can do it now. Perfect movie, 6 out of 10. Hell
yeah. Yeah, I agree. It does what it says on the tin.
Yeah, I am.
Monsters and Hunters.
Yeah.
Yep. Lots of weird references. Ron Perlman, who now is like a 70-80-year-old man. I forgot which one it was, but he's very old, still kicking ass. Yeah.
So we'll never get a sequel?
Probably not.
I mean, I really hope we do.
I kind of hope, no. I don't know
like,
which
if
way
it does,
I like.
Look, if it does well in China, then we might get our sequel.
Yeah, but it had all those issues. Look, just could totally spoil the movie. They only arrive at the plot at the end of the film. They don't.
It's the intro.
Yeah, they don't get to the plot.
Oh, yeah. This is Monster Hunter 1.8.
Yeah.
Or 0.8, I guess.
Yeah. It is.
You think there's going to be another act. And it's like, no, movie's over.
Credits.
And I was okay with it. Like, okay.
I laughed till I stopped. It was. Yeah. If you got the right attitude, that movie is great. If you're expecting something.
If you are expecting something, why?
What's wrong with you? Look at who's involved. Monster Hunter's cool, but also look at
Resident
Monster
Evil
Hunter.
Movies and ask yourself why you're expecting
it. More enjoyable than the last like 3 Resident Evil movies, for sure.
Yeah, see, look,
Probably most of them, actually.
I enjoy all of those movies.
Oh, I tried some of those really later ones.
I think I've seen the last
trash
couple.
Thing, I love them.
The one where there's like 1,000 Miljovovichs in the desert. Yeah. I'm like, what is going on?
Oh, man.
It's not even that I've forgotten what is happening. It's in the film. I can't follow the filmmaking.
Well, like they land a plane on a tiny rooftop and then take off again and everything's good.
Why not? Okay. But this is supposed to be the end of the show. So, we will be back and we'll talk about some video games, including...
I might be past
my hidden things, which no one knows about and doesn't care about. It's on my list. It's good. Kinda. Yeah. I don't know. We'll find out what's
the embargo
about.
On
We shall I'll have to check the dates. Yeah. But one of the big things
I have quite a lot to say about that, I think.
Yeah. I think we might just save it to the thing because
it give me time to play it, because I haven't played it.
Yeah. There were a bunch of Steam Festival games. I played through I think like 38. But I've got the other ones. I've got a bunch of others installed.
Mm.
So last time they did one of these, even when they took the demos down, they still worked if you had them installed.
Mm.
So I might still get to play through a bunch of them. So we'll find out. But for now, thank you for watching 8.5bit. You can go to our website, 8.5bit.com, Twitter, Facebook. Please like and share anything like that. Subscribe to us on whatever the hell you want. And join our Discord at discord.8.5bit.com if you want to talk some shit and hear about James' baby. Actually, he doesn't talk about it very much on there at all. We mainly just talk about video game stuff. Because
I try to not be that guy.
Man, children.
You got to follow him on Instagram for that.
Yeah. Oh, like I post baby clips, but then even then, most of them I just post to stories.
Yeah.
Because I feel bad. Like I feel not.
And then they pop up on Facebook and Twitter. And
yeah.
Instagram.
Well, because I don't want to be the guy that's just like spamming everyone like in my feed with baby photos. But I have family that really want to see it, so I find the stories work well because they're just there for 24 hours to disappear. So it doesn't look they're not like being forced upon you.
Look, like this isn't just recommend an app thing, and there are some problems with this app, and you can do it with other stuff, but it's just what my family started using. There's an app called Family Album, and it just catalogs and keeps all of your photos of like separated into each child.
See, we just use a shared album on.
That's a simple way of doing it. But it has some. It's very good for the people that may be less literate in things.
See, I think that'd be great, but I'd really struggle getting everyone else onto it. Where I found apparently my family is split between Instagram and Facebook pretty much evenly. So I just found going to Instagram, which then pushes to Facebook, I just get good coverage.
Good work. Okay, and anyway, we were saying goodbye.
Anyway, yeah.
Listen to me on Zed Games.
That's more important.
It's my show next week.
Oh, lucky.
Yeah.
Excited?
I always make a bit of an effort. Get some cool music.
Yeah.
Mm. Get some scoops.
Do you have hot takes?
No. Especially Australian devs with games coming up soon. I contact them and get like music that's not released yet.
Ah.
And I'm like, yeah. I mean, honestly, hey, if I haven't contacted you and you're an Australian dev and you have a game in development that has music and it might work on the radio, hit me up because I'll play. Like, we want Australian music. Yeah. We want game music. Hit me up. Do it. It's really hard to meet quotas. It's not that hard, actually. Okay, catch you later.
Hey, everyone.
Bye.